as we were born naturally to believe the creator is perfect. You see? So now when you start analyzing the religion, any religion, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, which of these religion goes in line with the universal knowledge that the creator has given us? Is it Judaism? Is it Christianity? Is it Islam? Let me tell you about Islam. Okay? Islam is simple. There's one creator who created his creation based upon his wisdom and his mercy and his justice. He chose people amongst us, from our human beings, from the human beings, yeah? To convey his message. However, when he chose prophets and messengers, he knew that some people are going to claim to be prophets of God, but they are liars. So what he did, he gave them something that differentiates them from the rest of the people. So miracles, prophecies, they were known amongst the nations to be trustworthy, truthful, honest people. Likewise, God aid them and aid their followers. Likewise, they come with the same teaching, even though they never met each other. So when you look to Islam, what is it? Worship one God, believe Prophet Moses, Jesus, Abraham, Noah, Jacob, Isaac, Jeremiah, Ishmael. Last of them is the Prophet Muhammad. And we believe this life is a test. And we believe that the best way to worship God, according to his teaching. We believe if I was alive at the time of Jesus, the only way to worship God correctly is if I was an Israelite by following Jesus' teaching. Before Jesus, if I was alive at the time of Moses, if I want to worship God correctly, I have to follow Moses' teaching. Now the last prophet is Muhammad. Now in order for us to worship God correctly, we have to follow the teaching of Prophet Muhammad. Simple, logical, no God become a baby, because that doesn't make any sense. You as a Christian, you agreed with me that it's illogical. It is irrational to say God, who is perfect all the times, became a baby.
Okay. Is that what he was saying?
No, that's what the Christians believe. Because the Christians believe Jesus was God and he became a baby, became human. That is a paradox. By definition, human being are human. By definition, God is God and is no human being. So tell me, God, who is perfect, become imperfect, but he's perfect all the times. That doesn't make any sense. Do you agree with that logic?
Yeah, I wouldn't say I'm very religious though, to be honest.
What I'm trying to explain to you, bro, I'm trying to explain to you the foundation of Islam and showing you the foundation of any religion.
Okay.
To show you which foundations go in line with our universal knowledge that the Creator has given us. Why the Creator has given us a universal knowledge? Because the Creator knows that he's going to send down a revelation to go in line with that universal knowledge. In order for you and I to see which one is going to go in line with us. As I said, Christianity, look, Judaism. God regrets, rest, refresh, you know. And likewise, Judaism, the way they portrayed God is like tribal God. It's just about them. Israelite, Israelite, Israelite. But when you look to Islam, God of everyone. Yes, there was a time Allah favored some nations after other nations. But Allah is still the God of everything. You see, what I said to you so far, does it make sense? So when you look to Prophet Muhammad, a person might say, why you believe Prophet Muhammad is a true prophet? Okay. Firstly, Prophet Muhammad, as I have said, was known to be trustworthy, truthful, honest amongst his nation. You knew his history. Now let me give you an example from his biography to establish that this man must be trustworthy, truthful. During his lifetime, eclipse happened. You know, eclipse, yeah? Occurred. His companions, his followers, were not familiar with it. An eclipse happened in the same day that Prophet Muhammad's son, alayhi salatu wasalam, passed away. His followers, they're not familiar with eclipse. So what they did, they tried to connect this to that by saying the reason eclipse happened because the Prophet Muhammad's son passed away. Listen to this, yeah? We know a liar. A liar would try to look for any opportunity to back up his claim, correct? If I'm a liar, I'm claiming to be a prophet of God, anything I believe is going to support my claim, I'm going to try to utilize it. Because I'm a liar. I have no proof from God. You with me? But look what the Prophet Muhammad did. He said, no, what happened, eclipse, it has nothing to do with no one's life and no one's death. What occurred is from God. So when you see it, go pray and give charity. What he did, he connect them to God, not to himself. And that is not the nature of a liar. A liar, when he lies, he wants to manipulate the people. He wants to control and everything, yeah? Now let me give you another example to show this man is a trustworthy, truthful. Once, one of his followers was married to a woman, okay? This woman, she said, I don't want to stay with you anymore to this person, yeah? The follower of Prophet Muhammad SAW. So Prophet Muhammad came to her because this person loved her so much and he was following her everywhere. So Prophet Muhammad SAW, he went to her and said, listen, why don't you go back to him? She said, oh, Messenger of Allah, is that commandment from Allah? Or you just, you are trying to be a mediator? He said, no, it's not a commandment from Allah. I'm just trying to help because, you know, here we can see, that's not the liar will say, no, he's my follower. Allah told me, go back to him. So go back to him. No, he said, I'm just a mediator. I'm trying to help. Understand? Another example, when the Prophet Muhammad, someone invited him to his house, said, oh, Muhammad, oh, Messenger of Allah, come to my house, eat food. The Messenger of Allah, he was walking, he met someone, and he started following him. You know the door. The person opened the door. He said, oh, so and so. I didn't bring him with me. You with me? I didn't bring him with me. He's followed me. It's up to you to tell him, go back or to come in, because it's your house. He did not say, I'm a messenger of Allah, he's my friend, you have to accept him. So you can see from his biography. My point here is, I'm establishing this man must be truthful and honest. Because why? You can see from his characteristics, he's not characteristics of a liar. You with me? Okay. Now, that's one of the characteristics. Prophecies. We know that the only one that knows the future in detail is the Creator. Correct? Okay. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ prophesied about the future. For example, he said there will be a person make up a lie in the morning. In the same morning, his lies will reach far east, far west. Far east, far east, far west. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ existed 1,400 years ago. Back in those days, in order to travel from here to Cardiff would take us 3 days. Let alone for our lie to spread far east, far west in the same morning. Now what you can do, make up a lie, put it on Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat, we'll go everywhere. How we knew that? How we knew that? Because he clearly said, he's a messenger of Allah, from God. Not just one, because there is a fortune teller. They can tell you something about the future. But it's not just one, another one. He said there will come a time with the interest, not interest, will become widespread, yeah? Even if you are not involved directly, will affect you. You know now, when you open a bank account, you get involved interest. When you go to Tesco, interest. Now we live in a time we cannot escape interest. Again, how he knew that? Because he said clearly, he received the revelation from the Most High. And from that which he received, that he's a messenger of Allah, and that to follow his teaching, to worship Allah correctly. And I always mention this example, bro. Imagine you're in a house, and you are surrounded with a fire. You are about to die. You know, you tried to save yourself, but you couldn't, you gave up. I came and I saved your life. What would you say to me at least? Would you remember me all the time? Of course, I saved your life, bro. You're about to be burned alive, you know? So why we are not grateful and thankful and remember the one that gave us life for free? You see?
When you have time, can I speak to you?
Yeah, okay. Sure.
Off camera.
Okay, yeah.
Another thing. I want to speak to him now. I was just listening, bro. I was listening to your talk. No,
yeah. But you know, from Allah.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying to you...
I'm not a very religious person.
No problem.
More just listening.
But what I'm giving you a reminder.
Yeah.
That what's happened in our society, we are not asking the big questions.
But do you think you can still be grateful without believing in God, for example?
No, you cannot. You cannot. Because how can you be great? How can you be grateful to your life, for your life, and you're not being grateful to the one who gave it to you?
But what if I don't believe that he gave it to me, for example?
So that's a contradiction. Why?
In
because in one sense, who gave you life?
My parents gave me life.
So your parents gave you life. Okay, so let us analyze that. Your parents gave you life. So how come when you die, they can give you life again?
That's not how biology works.
So it was not up to them then?
Huh?
It was not up to them.
They're able to reproduce, but they're not able to
give you a life, you.
There you go.
Your parents was a means two brought you into existence, but they were not the one gave you life.
Through biology, though.
No doubt about that. Yeah. But they were not the means to give you life. For example, let me give you an example. I can make light. I can make a button and a lamp, but if I don't, I cannot make electricity. So who's making? Who's giving us electricity? Like who making it? It's someone else. So my point here is, your father and your mother, they were a means to bring you into existence, but they're not the one who gave you life. Because if it was up to them to begin with to give you a life, they will be able to give a life again. So therefore, they never gave you life to begin with. Someone outside gave you life. Do you understand my point?
I understand what you're saying, but that's not what I believe. No, but
it makes sense more than what you...
In some ways, but that's based on the opinion that you believe that God gave
you. No, that's rational. That's based upon a universal knowledge. Because for the sake of argument, who gave you parents life? Now, let's go back.
Parents.
It has to end. It has to stop at someone. Okay? So who gave you life?
Yeah. There's
so I'm saying.
That's something. But for me...
How does it begin? Huh?
Let me finish. You want to say something? Yeah. For you what?
Okay, so I have a science background, let's say.
Yeah, no problem.
I studied biology. What I believe is that just because science can't explain how the world universe doesn't mean that I'm going to believe that answer should be God.
I understand that, but what I'm saying to you, look, now...
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense, because what people they say, what happened in the Western world, when they couldn't explain something natural, they say God. So they call it the gap of the God of the gap. Okay? I don't believe it's God of the gap. Because I believe God, you can explain something biologically, physically, however, that does not negate God created it.
Yeah, but that's whether or not you believe that God created it.
Now we're going to come to that. Now, for example, if I explain how the camera works, doesn't mean no one made the camera. You see? Doesn't not negate. Learning how the camera works does not necessitate no one made it.
Understand? I understand what
you're saying. Argument is that doesn't mean because we know how some of the things that works within the universe, therefore we don't need God. That is the wrong way. Now let us come to the argument which is Quran mentioned, the logical argument. Okay, either this creation was created by something or by nothing. Which one is it?
By something or nothing.
Nothing, yeah.
Say again, sorry.
Either this creation was created by something or by nothing. Okay. Which one is it?
Well, I don't believe in God, so I would say it wasn't created by anything.
So by nothing, basically?
Yeah, by nothing.
But that doesn't make any sense, because nothing...
Well, science would say that it started with the Big Bang.
Yeah, a Big Bang is an action.
What was the cause?
It was the cause, because Big Bang is like someone telling me someone made a camera.
I agree with you, because I've spoken with other Muslims. And this is the exact point they say to me.
That's what Allah said. Yeah. Listen to this,
yeah? It's a personal choice, so I don't...
No, but you have something called universal knowledge. Universal knowledge, you know that for something to come into existence, someone must bring it into existence. You know that. How do we know that? Not because we experienced it or because we learned it from our society. No, it's something which is well rooted within us. The proof of that, imagine you have a baby, 2 months, and you hit him in the back, the baby naturally start looking. You know why it start looking? Because the baby naturally knows that in order for a cause to occur, for effect to occur, you must have a cause. You see? Cause and effect. And that's what Allah said in the Quran. Would they create?
He is the cause. Allah is the cause.
That's what Allah said in the Quran.
My question to you would be, why wouldn't it not be another God, let's say?
No, okay. Before we go to that, firstly, let us establish who is God.
Interested.
No problem, brother. Yeah. Ask any questions.
Yeah.
Don't ask me how old I am. That's it.
Okay.
Don't ask any questions. I'm joking. My point here is that God said in the Quran, would they create by nothing? Or did they create themselves? Or did they create the heavens and the earth? Surely they have no firm belief. This is a rational argument. Firstly, did we create by nothing? Nothing is not even a thing, let alone to create something else. So that is illogical. Did we create ourselves? That is illogical. Because why? In order to create yourself, you have to exist. And if you already exist, There's no need to create yourself because you already exist.
Yeah, well, I would probably look at something like evolution in terms of...
We'll come to evolution after. We're talking about the creation, you know, the beginning. Okay. Evolution has nothing to do with the beginning of the creation. Okay, evolution was more about how the species came about, you know, not about the universe.
Okay, about
So now, or we create the heavens and the earth. You know what Allah said? Surely they have no firm belief. And it's a reality, we speak to scientists. So my point here is, before we start saying which God, but we have to accept that either this universe is created by nothing or by something. Logical way, rational way, must be created by something. And that thing must have a power. You see, must have what? Knowledge. Because if I don't know how to create something, I cannot make it. I have to prove, must have what? Will. Must have what? Wisdom, you know? So you can see that. How do we know that? When we analyze the manifestation of this creation. There is an atheist scientist from Britain. He wrote a book called, it's from Oxford University.
Richard Dawkins.
No, Richard Dawkins is not the best one. Richard Dawkins, you know, when he wrote his book, Delusion of God, many atheists mocked him for that. Richard Dawkins, you know what people, just a side point. Do you know why people like Richard Dawkins? Richard Dawkins is very wise man.
Yeah,
in what way?
Man.
You know what? In what way? He simplified physics and science to layman. You see, that's why people like him. You see, however, he's not more smarter than Anthony Flew. Anthony Flew. Anthony Flew, one of the scientists. He was an atheist for 50 years. Then he became a believer in God. He said, the reason I became a believer in God, because for the sake of argument, let us say this universe came about by chance. But the law, this universe follow specific law. Everything follow specific law that cannot come randomly. It's illogical to believe that. Why Anthony Flew believe in God? Because Anthony Flew, what was good about him, when the people that believed in God used to respond to him, he used to read their works. So that's why he started asking the question. Richard Dawkins, you can listen to his arguments. His arguments clearly has not spoken to someone who is knowledgeable about religion. He speaks to a people like, for example, there was a Christian theologist in America challenged Richard Dawkins for debate. Richard Dawkins didn't want a debate with him, you know? So anyway, let's come back here. So you must have power, ability, and what? Knowledge. Now, which God? Like I said, you have the universal knowledge. Now, when you look to, everything there is a purpose, correct? So when God sent the prophets and messengers, he gave them something differentiated from the rest of the people. Like Prophet Muhammad. I don't have to speak about Jesus, Moses. When the Prophet Muhammad came with Islam and came with the Quran, he came with something people cannot bring it. And from his claim that God sent me with that. And if you're saying that I'm lying, then challenge me. So what happened? No one was able to challenge the Quran. No one was able to challenge his teaching. Rather, he prophesies about many prophecies that we can observe, we can see right now. Rather, one of the prophecies that Allah mentioned in the Quran, that Islam will spread around the world, even if the enemies of Islam dislike it. And we know there is a huge war against Islam. Yes, some Muslims are causing that, like ISIS other than them. They are evil people without any doubt. However, in social media, in news, every single day in America or France, bad news about Islam. However, the fastest growing religion on the face of the earth is Islam. Who's doing the job? We as the Muslims, we are weak. You know who's doing the job? The Most High. Allah mentioned that 1,400 years ago. So as a Muslim, when I see Quran, when I see what's happening now, and I read the Quran, I know this speech is a speech of the one who created this creation. And he has informed himself, informed me and you about himself. What do you think what I said so far? Does it follow the logic?
I'm following you.
The rationality?
I'm following you.
If you notice, I'm not telling you believe in Islam because Allah said so. No, I'm showing you how Islam rationalized, how Allah rationalized his claim to be the creator of everything. How Allah rationalized that the Quran, his speech, how Allah rationalized why the Prophet Muhammad is a messenger of Allah. That's why the beauty of Islam is goes in line with our common sense and our natural inclination. You understand, bro?
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
When you come to science, science, they cannot answer it.
Yeah.
And if you don't believe, look, let me just tell you something, bro, yeah? I'm sorry for taking your time.
Oh, no, absolutely.
Thank you very much. The outcome of not believing God, you know what is the outcome of that? We'll have no certainty about nothing. Do you know why?
I don't know if I agree with that.
No. Let us analyze that. Do you know why? Okay. If there is no God, therefore we came randomly. We are a product of blind matter, chemical reaction. Correct?
Yeah.
Like Richard Dawkins said that, Sam Harris, Lawrence Krauss, okay? Therefore, where we are getting good and bad from. Richard, Charles Darwin, when he wrote his letter to one of his friends, he said, there's one thing keep troubling me.
Yeah, what's that?
He said, how can we trust our brain if we know our brain evolved from a monkey? Can we trust brain of a monkey? You see, so if there's no God, basically everything is random. There's no difference between you and a tree and a monkey and a chicken and a stone. All of us were just a reaction of blind matter. So why there is good, why there is bad? Where are we getting that from?
But do you think you can still be a good person without believing in God, for example?
If there is no God, what does it mean, good person?
Maybe you haven't found him yet.
No, no, wait, brother. You're moving, you're stepping. If there is no God, what is good person? We are blind of matter. We are product of blind matter. Where do you get this good from?
In a sense of morality, like knowing what's good and bad.
Where do you get that from?
Huh?
Where do you get that from? Blind matter cannot give you morality. If we are, do you know why I'm saying that? You following me, yeah?
Well, no, I mean, I'm listening to you.
If we are blind, if we are a product of a blind matter
yeah.
and a chemical reaction, where we
know,
are...
I don't know whether God exists or not, but generally I'm not very religious, okay? But I know if I punch you in the face, that's a bad thing.
Why is bad?
Because I just know that.
Yeah, but how can you trust something which is it's just atoms
because
in your head?
Because society and culture tells you what's good. Ah,
so if another society tells you it's good to punch people, it'll be okay.
Well, different societies have different cultures.
So when Hitler was killing Jewish people, so therefore it's okay for them.
Well, it's not in that sense, obviously.
No, it is, because why? You now, morality is subjective, not objective. Do you agree with that? Subjective means...
No, I agree that morality should be objective.
That's the only way to be objective is from the Most High. You see?
I would disagree with that.
So how can you... Okay, prove to me morality to be objective without the Creator.
That's something that humans are capable of, let's say.
Yeah, but remember,
objective morality.
How can we establish that?
Who will get to decide to make
that's my question now. Who decides what's objective or is not?
You might differ to what I think. Yeah. I might think it's good to do something, but you might say it's bad. Then me and you just gonna go
ahead. Yeah. No, I agree.
See, you know what? That's what Allah said in the Quran. Allah spoke about Pharaoh in the Quran. Pharaoh said to Moses, "Oh Moses, who is the God of everything you are claiming that we should worship?" He said, "The Lord of the heavens and the earth and that which is between them, if you have any certainty." What does it mean? The Muslim scholar said meaning here, if you have any certainty, then you should have certainty about this tremendous creation must have a creator. And if you don't have that certainty, therefore you have no certainty about anything else. And that's the outcome of not believing God. You see, that's why one of the ways to prove God's existence is the objective morality. Because there's many ways proving God's existence. We can come from a rational way, from the morality, from the miracles, prophecies, overwhelming. That's why we believe the biggest crime and the most evil thing. Listen carefully, yeah? What is the greatest evil, according to you? What is the greatest evil? Raping a baby, let us say.
Okay,
let us say raping a baby, yeah? Okay. I'll tell you that raping a baby, there's something which is worse than it. That person, what led him to rape a baby, because he turned away from the God's teaching. You know? So therefore, the worst sin, when you turn away from God. Because when you turn away from God, you have no objective morality. All everything is subjective to you. Because if you tell him, don't rape the baby, he's going to say, hold a minute, you're a product of blind matter. I'm a product of blind matter. Who you tell me what to do? Maybe to you is not good, to me it's good.
Yeah,
and what is good?
You both know that you shouldn't.
Do you know why we know that? Do you know why we know that? Because it's called naturally. Do you know who put that within us? It's God. That's my point.
Huh?
I know, you knew you were going to say that. Yeah, I understand that.
I know that that's not a good thing.
Yeah, we know, but yeah. That's what he means by a differentiated opinion.
That's why you need the creator. Yeah. That's why.
But not everyone creator. Else, I agree that he knew that that was a bad thing, but that doesn't mean that.
He also had followers, so a bunch of people followed him.
You know, Richard Dawkins said, yeah? You know, because we mentioned Richard Dawkins. Richard Dawkins said, he said that we cannot say objectively that we can, sorry, we cannot say objectively what Hitler said, did was wrong. He says, yeah, I disagree with him, but you can, because many people don't understand the true meaning of atheism. That's why atheism, not believing God, I study about it, you know. Alhamdulillah, I study about it. And don't take everything from me, go do your own research. Go listen to what Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, who's asked, Lawrence Krauss, who's asked about having intercourse with your own mother or with your own daughter. Is he wrong? He said, we're not sure of something like that. You know why? I respect him for saying that. You know why? Because he is a true follower of atheism. You cannot accept atheism, then when it comes to morality, you start using Christian morality or Islam morality. That's what some atheists do. You see? That's why without God, then there will be no objective morality. Even what is good, what is bad, what does it mean good? It will begin with. You see, that's why I want to tell you, bro, study, learn, what we have to understand that one day we're going to die. Sooner or later, we're going to live this life. The big question that I was telling you about, why we're here, why we have to die, what will happen after the death. All these questions, the Most High, who created this tremendous creation, has answered it in his noble book, which is the Quran, which is a message for all mankind. So if you have any questions or something.
No, I was just listening. But
alhamdulillah, you know, alhamdulillah, you were here because you said something which is true. Because you know what, when I speak with like two Jewish boys,
yeah.
I started doubting myself. I was thinking, am I saying something crazy? But you said no, they were playing around. They wouldn't answer the question. Yes, they wouldn't answer the question clearly. Yeah, because why? Simple question. God, yeah, see, yeah, alhamdulillah. Because you know, sometimes you need to speak to someone and he's not answering, he's not thinking, maybe I'm not speaking English. Maybe I'm speaking another language or something, you understand? Now, alhamdulillah, bro. So that's why I'm calling you to reflect, study, read. I'm not about any leaflets. But
another thing I was going to say to the brother about Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam being.
Say again?
About Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam
being
a miracle.
About Prophet Muhammad.
I mean, in my opinion, you can correct me, the biggest, one of the greatest miracles is that he was illiterate. He couldn't read, he couldn't write, and he's in the desert, right? So how was he able to kind of like talk about the embryo in the stomach, talk about iron being in the center of the earth, talk about there's ocean, one side is sweet, one side is salt.
No, brother, that's why you cannot use it too much, you know why? Because they were in Jewish scripture, they mentioned something like that as well.
Yeah,
so that is not only to the Quran, you understand?
No, I understand that.
So the Greek
philosophers. God is talking.
No, wait. Greek philosophers knew about things like that.
Yeah, but how did they know?
Yeah, but Greek philosophers didn't believe in God.
Yeah, but how did they know these things?
No, brother, look.
And you have to go to the point, because it may have come from the scriptures. We believe in Torah and Jesus.
You are trying to utilize modern science, okay? There is a limit to it. Modern science don't use everything. For example, about the embryo, there was some stuff that Greek philosophers knew about. There's some stuff got it wrong, but Islam put everything right, you know, about how the embryo developed. However, you cannot just say because of this, therefore, no, you cannot just say that because why?
No, but he was illiterate.
I understand that, but they're going to tell you, okay, if you accept that, so you have to accept Aristotle received the revelation from God, because Aristotle knew about something about the embryo.
But I had that question asked to me.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. We as a Muslim, me personally, I don't like to use modern science too much. Firstly, yes, there's some stuff in Islam about embryo, which he mentioned. Yes, however, there is some stuff, Islam mentioned it, Allah mentioned it, but also was known before to other people, you understand? So we can, because you cannot say, because of that, that's why Prophet Muhammad is a true prophet. Because the person say, okay, but what you just told me was known before that. You see, that's why when I try to prove Prophet Muhammad's prophethood, I utilize something specific for him, which cannot be shared by anyone else. For example, how a man that came with a book, and he mentioned 1,400 years ago, that this book will be memorized by everyone, made easy to be memorized. This is a claim. Jewish people that have the scripture. Christian, they have the scripture. But the only book that it has been memorized by 100 million of people, word for word, letter for letter, is the Islamic book, the Quran. Our man that lived 1,400 years ago said that. Also, he said, Allah said that in the Quran, Prophet Muhammad conveyed. In the Quran, Allah said he will preserve the Quran. This is a claim. Okay, it's a claim. Now, not because someone claimed, made a claim, was to believe. We have to verify the claim, correct? Now, what we can do, if the Christians and the Jewish people and the Muslims come all together and burn our scriptures, the only book that will remain with us and we can bring it into written form is the Quran. So the Quran will never be lost. Of course, until the end of the day, we believe before the end of time, Allah will raise it. However, the claim that has been made in the Quran, we can verify it. The Quran, what distinguishes the Quran from any scripture, not just claim to be from God, it goes beyond that. Challenge people, makes claims, and challenge people to disprove the claim. That is not the nature of someone who is a liar. If I'm a liar, I'm not going to challenge people because I know what I came with, I made it up. And I know some people are able to bring something like it. But if I know what I have is from the Most High, I know no one can challenge me. And that's what the Prophet Muhammad did. He challenged people. You understand? But this one, there is you want to go?
No. What do you think, like, moving forward, like, in the future, in terms of, you know, you have all these conflicts between religions, different peoples. Like, what do we need to do as a world to resolve these conflicts and to move forward to a better state where we're not, you know what I mean, where there isn't so much conflict and tension between people?
Okay, that is a good question. Islam pays attention to that. I believe, as a Muslim, that in order for us to have a good life, but again, this life is not meant to be just everything. We have to be in peace. It's a test, because we believe this life was created as a test for us, okay? However, to be brothers and sisters, the only way to be good brothers and sisters, true brothers and sisters, by following the teaching of the Most High. Why? Because the Most High gives us objective way. You see, that's my point earlier on, that if there's no God, everything will be subjective. Understand? So in order for us to move forward, brothers and sisters, look, Prophet Muhammad came to nation, they were known to kill each other. They were known to bury their own daughters alive. They used to wage a war. He came to people, firstly he came to nations, they were known to kill each other.
For water,
wage a war. They were known to bury their daughters alive. Bury their daughters alive, yeah? They will wage a war 40 years, 50 years, kill each other. He came to them and he changed them completely. They become brothers and sisters. So the best example, if you want to follow, how the Prophet Muhammad changed his followers. Not just that, how Islam civilized the people after that. And you know, I'm not sure if you know about history. Do you know about history?
Like, it's a big thing.
I'm talking about mostly Islamic civilization. Islamic civilization, for example, I will highly recommend you to watch a documentary on BBC called the Islamic Civilization in Andalusia. Andalusia.
South of Spain.
Yes, Spain and Portugal. Yeah, write it and see how. And there was a book. There was a book written. I forgot the name. Called How Islam Developed the Modern World. How Islam developed the modern world. Because no doubt there's a huge war against Islam, you're not gonna hear this stuff. But it's very amazing how BBC made a program about it. Yeah. About Islamic civilization in Andalusia. So what it teach us here, that Islam teach you how to look after yourself spiritually and physically and mentally. You know, Islam pays attention to two. So everything. Islam, because Christianity mainly focuses on spirits. Just spirits, you know. Judaism, just on matters. You know, money. That's what it is. If you look to the Old Testament, it's more focusing on, like, physical things. Islam combined between the two. That's why one of the companion of the Prophet Muhammad said, he said, work for your life as if you will never die. work for this life as if you will never die. And work for the day of judgment as if you're going to die tomorrow. So look the balance. You know, Prophet Muhammad said, even if you hear the day of judgment is going to happen tomorrow and you have a seed, then plant it. Take effect. You know, so Islam teach, when we say Islam, Islam doesn't mean go to the mosque 24 hours. No, Islam is a comprehensive religion. What is worship in Islam? Worship in Islam. Making money to take care of yourself and your mother, that is worship in Islam. Taking out of the environment, that is worship in Islam. Taking care of the orphans, that is worship in Islam. Taking care of the animals, that is worship in Islam. Taking care of the people, that is worship in Islam. Creating new things to facilitate, to make it easier for the people, that is worship in Islam. So worship in Islam, not only in the mosque, is to deal with the hereafter and with this life. If we implement this teaching, then we have a good life. However, doesn't mean we will not be tested, because God already mentioned this life is a test. It's like a bridge. You know, when you go to university, doesn't mean that we should be good to each other, therefore we're not going to have a test anymore. You still have a test, because university is there for you to study and have the exam. That's why, likewise, this life. You understand that? You see? That's what we need. That's what we need, brother. And I will. I don't have any leaflets with me, but read and study more. No, search, brother. Wallahi, it's a serious matter. It's a serious matter. You don't want to die. Because as a Muslim, I'll tell you what I believe. We believe that, as I said, the biggest crime against humanity and against God, when you turn away from God. And God has attribute of mercy and the attribute of anger. And has a day, which is called Day of Judgment, which God will judge